Hey guys, Nate Schoemer here, and today we're going to be talking about everything you need to know when training a new puppy. People often ask me, how many sessions a day do I like to get in with a new puppy? And when do I start training a new puppy? And how long should these sessions be? Well, the moment I bring a puppy home, that puppy is learning. So I want to start training them right away. I usually like to get in between 1 to 3 sessions a day. Each session is about 5 to 15 minutes. We want to keep them short and we want to make them as fun as possible. We want the puppy to enjoy it. In fact, I try to make training the most fun that the dog will have throughout the entire day. So they're always looking forward to training. And if your dog is looking forward to training, then they're going to learn much faster. When training a new puppy, I like to use mealtime as training time. I don't like to give puppies really high value treats. The reason for this, if you're giving your puppy something very high value, it's like giving them a pay raise. And then if you try to give them a lower value reward, like the food that you're feeding them, their kibble, they're not going to want to work for it. So I like to have the puppy in the very beginning working for their meals. It increases the value of mealtime, but it also makes it much easier to train a puppy. You certainly do not want to free feed your puppy. If you do, you could be setting yourself up for failure. So make sure you don't do that. And if you don't have time to train your puppy, there's a few things that you can do. One, what I like to do is, if I don't have that much time, only a couple minutes, then when I'm working with the puppy, I'll give them larger handfuls of rewards for each behavior. This is going to give me an opportunity to still use training time as an opportunity to build that habit of wanting to work for food, but it also prevents me from having to feed them out of a bowl. If you don't have time to train your puppy one day or during one session where you normally would, don't allow this to be a missed opportunity. What a lot of people do is they'll unintentionally create separation anxiety. And they do that because they take the puppy and they put the puppy in the crate only when they're leaving the house and they're going to be gone for a long period of time. That could stress the puppy out. They could become bored and they could develop really bad separation anxiety, which is something you most certainly do not want your puppy to have to experience. So take this opportunity and use it to have the puppy enjoy the crate and satisfy the need to chew. I like to use either a raw bone or a Kong. I take the puppy's meal, I'll put it in a bowl, and then I'll put in water to allow the water to be soaked up into the dog's kibble. Then I'll take that food, stuff it into the raw bone or the Kong, and I will freeze it. Once it's frozen, I give it to the puppy. This gives them something to do while satisfying that need to chew, and it makes the crate a more pleasant experience. So you're less likely to end up with a puppy that develops separation anxiety. And speaking of crates, you also want to keep the crate next to your bed at night. You want to do this because when a puppy is really young, if they're separated from their mom, they will whine or they will cry to get the mom to come back to them to save them since they can't take care of themselves. They'll do that if you leave them in a separate room. Now, I've heard people say, well, you shouldn't bring them into the room because then you're going to be rewarding bad behavior. This is not rewarding bad behavior by keeping the puppy next to you. It's providing them with the security that they need at such a young age. They're not trying to manipulate you when they're 8 weeks of age and they're whining in the crate. What I like to do while the puppy's crate is next to me, if they do start to whine, I'll often place my fingers in the crate, just letting them know, hey buddy, I'm still here, no reason to stress out. And this brings me to the next thing, which is fear. We don't want to start reinforcing fear by comforting our puppies when they're afraid, meaning it's okay, good puppy, it's okay. We don't want to do that because what we're telling our puppy is it's good to be scared. Yes, you should be scared. That's not something we want to do. So instead, they can feed off of us or they feed off of other dogs. I act like it's not a big deal or I act like it's predicting something fun. If you saw my firework video, fireworks go off, instead of being like, oh no, what's that? I get excited. I go, oh, it's time to train, guys. Let's go out. Let's play fetch. Let's have a good time. So then the sound of the fireworks is predicting something fun, and it changes the way that our dogs will look at it. You're also going to want to start potty training your puppy right away. Don't make the mistake of getting puppy pads and using those inside the house unless you want your puppy to go to the bathroom inside of the house, because that's what a potty pad is doing. Dogs are very situational. If you teach them to go inside the house by using a puppy pad, then they will think that it's okay to go in the house, even when the puppy pad is removed. So make sure this is not something that you practice unless you want your puppy to go potty inside the house. We're gonna wanna start crate training, and crate training is our opportunity to potty train. Crate training is potty training, but it also teaches our puppy not to practice bad behaviors. If your puppy is still learning how to properly behave inside the house, you shouldn't leave your puppy unattended without eyes on. You have to be able to see them at all times, because if they do something that you don't like and you're not there to redirect them to something that's okay, and they start practicing that behavior, that's going to be something they own for life. We don't want them doing these bad behaviors. So if your puppy, again, is still at the early stages, make sure you have eyes on. It's no different than having a toddler in the house. First time a toddler starts walking around the house, you're not going to let them explore the house without having eyes on. You have to be there to say, don't touch that. That's sharp. That's dangerous. Don't stick your fingers into the outlet. Things like that. Same with the puppy. We have to watch them, make sure they don't practice behaviors we don't want them doing as they get older. The next big thing to keep in mind is confidence building. You want a really confident dog. I talked about this in another video, and I referenced the movie Bolt. Why was Bolt so confident? Because they made him believe that he was a super dog. When I'm raising a young puppy, I'm doing the same thing. I'm exposing them to a lot of new things while making those experiences pleasant. One of the things that I like to do is I'll get an empty kiddie pool and I'll fill it with empty plastic bottles. It makes a loud noise. I make it fun for my puppies and I make it a game. This increases their confidence because they're hearing these loud noises, but they're associating it with something fun. We want them to walk on different surfaces. We want to expose them to different things, and at the same time, making it fun by either it predicting play or predicting some sort of reward. The concept of confidence building is actually quite simple. We just take something, we make it predict something pleasant, therefore creating a positive association for the puppy. Another thing that I like to do is I like to show puppies how big and strong they are. For example, if I'm playing tug with a puppy, I'm not ripping the tug away to show the puppy how big and strong I am, but I instead let them push into me and I might fall back, or they shake and the toy is ripped out of my hand. I'm trying to show them how confident they are. Look at it this way. A lot of dogs are okay with puppies. They're not aggressive towards puppies. Now, on occasions, you will find a dog that can be aggressive towards a puppy, but most dogs aren't. And the reason for this is because the puppy is not a threat. An older dog can be a threat, and that can create something like a dog fight. But when they're not threatening, more often than not, they're not going to be aggressive towards them because they know they're not a threat. It's the same thing when you have a really confident dog. If you have a very, very confident dog, that dog is less likely to get into fights. That dog is less likely to have fear issues. That dog is going to learn much faster and be more willing to explore their world, and you're gonna have an all-around much better dog. So confidence building is very important. Make sure you start that right away with your puppy. And when it comes to confidence building, I like to expose my puppy to a lot of new things. And I know during the early stages, when your puppy hasn't received all their vaccinations, you want to be careful so they don't get sick or they don't get parvo. But what I like to do, even before my puppy has had all their shots, I might carry my puppy around the neighborhood. I'll walk around the block every single day, multiple times a day, just carrying my puppy, letting them see things, letting them kind of check out their world, what's out there. So I'm not taking them out for the very first time when they're already 16 weeks of age. At that point, we have missed the imprinting stages. Our puppy's imprinting stages is from when they're born up until 16 weeks of age. So what they learn during that time will often stick with them for life. So I want to make sure I'm exposing the puppy to as many things as possible. Like I said, I'll carry the puppy around. If the place does not have a lot of dog traffic, then it's okay to take the puppy to those locations as well. I wouldn't take a puppy that hasn't had all their vaccinations to something like a dog park or PetSmart, but I'm going to take them out. I'm going to carry them and I'm going to let them see as much as I can possibly expose them to. So it's no longer a big deal. I mean, think about it this way. If you were inside a cave your entire life and you came out for the very first time when you're an adult, you're going to be either scared or you're going to be wanting to check out everything. If you had a leash on, you might be pulling really hard to see what this is, to see what that, what's this over here. So we want to expose them. So then these new things are not a big deal and they're not freaking out when they get older. They're more relaxed and more calm out in public. This is why a lot of well-trained service dogs are very relaxed in public, because they've been exposed to it quite a bit when they were a young puppy. And they were taught in a sense that being out in town doesn't mean they have to go say hi to everybody. Doesn't mean that anybody's a threat, or doesn't mean that other dogs are a threat. It's just part of the environment. And that's something you're going to want to do with your own puppy to make sure they're as confident and comfortable as possible when you're outside of the house. Now it's time to start training our puppies. When we start training and we're doing an actual formal training session, again, we want to make it as fun as possible. And the very first thing that I start off with is engagement training. I have a video on exactly how to do this, but this is where we condition our dogs to the markers. So a marker is a word or sound that predicts a reward. It pinpoints a moment in time when the dog is correct or when the dog is incorrect as well. And again, we call it a marker because we are marking a moment in time. These are also known as condition reinforcers. A condition reinforcer predicts a primary. When our dog does a behavior we're trying to capture, we have to let them know within 1 second that they're doing a behavior we would like them to repeat. So in that 1 second, let's use a sit for example. The moment the dog's butt hits the ground, I have 1 second to either give the dog a primary reinforcer, food, toy, or affection, or I have 1 second to let the dog know they're going to get a primary reinforcer. And that's our condition reinforcer. That is our marker sounds. This could be a clicker. It could be yes. It could be free. It could be whatever word you want to use. I use yes and free for my dogs. So when I say that, my dogs know that they did the behavior correctly and they're going to receive a reward. And every single time you use a marker, no matter what that marker is, you have to follow through with the reward. So for me, if I tell my dog yes, I'm going to pay my dog. It is a guarantee you did the behavior correctly. You are going to get a reward. Don't start saying a marker and then fail to reward the dog. I've had people do that before. They're saying yes, they're not rewarding the dog, and oh, the dog's happy, so it's okay. Well, no, the dog was happy, or the puppy was happy, because they thought they were going to get a reward. We don't want to diminish the value of our yes or our free or whatever sound we're using by not rewarding them. That's like going to work somewhere, receiving a paycheck, and then the paycheck bounces. Well, you're going to stop working because it no longer predicts the primary reinforcer. So we have to make sure our paychecks never bounce when we're working with our dogs. Once I have my puppy conditioned to the condition reinforcer, the markers, then I start to use that in an exercise known as free shaping. Free shaping is when we don't have anything in mind we want our dog or our puppy to perform, but when they do something we like, we reward them for that. This shows them what behaviors we like them to perform inside of our house, and then our puppies are going to be more actively seeking out these behaviors because we've taught them it's something that we like. The way that we do this is very simple. We keep a reward inside of our pockets, hidden away from the dog or the puppy. When the puppy does a behavior that we like, yes, we mark that behavior and we give the puppy a reward. The puppy didn't see the reward, but the puppy's behavior is what made you say yes and what made you give them a reward. This helps create a proactive dog. This is the whole concept of operant conditioning. A dog that understands that their behavior has an effect on their environment so they can make things happen for themselves. So you get up in the morning, your puppy gets out of the crate and your puppy looks at you. Yes, you give your puppy a treat. Your puppy goes and lays down on his bed. Yes, you go give your puppy a treat. Your puppy sits. Yes, you give your puppy a treat. Your puppy lays down. Yes, you give your puppy a treat. You're showing your puppy exactly what you want them to do inside of your house or wherever, doesn't matter. And you're also showing them that their behavior can make rewards happen. This is a great way to not only create a proactive dog, but this is how we get our dogs to perform behaviors, whether or not we have rewards in sight. So most dogs are reactive. Your dog is probably reactive as well. You tell the dog to sit, the dog looks up at you and says, "You don't have a treat, why should I sit?" You pull out the treat, the dog goes, "Ooh, okay, I'll sit for that," and the dog sits. By doing this free shaping exercise, it teaches the puppy that their behavior can make rewards happen, whether or not they see the rewards. It's incredibly, incredibly powerful, and I highly recommend that everybody implement the concept of free shaping with their puppy. Now, once we have that completed, then the next training session, we're gonna start using luring to show our puppy every behavior we want them to perform. When I'm first teaching behaviors, I'm not worried about the verbal command, and I'm not worried about the puppy staying in the position. I'm simply giving the puppy a physical cue by luring, using food, to get them to perform all the behaviors that I would like them to perform, such as sit, go to their bed, down, come, heel, center, spin, you name it. We can use luring to teach almost every single behavior. Just remember, wherever the nose goes, the butt does the opposite. This is why a lot of people believe that they taught their dog to sit or their puppy to sit, even when they didn't. Because they tell the puppy, sit, 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 sit. The puppy goes, "What's that noise?" They look up, their butt naturally goes down. The human goes, "Yay, I taught my puppy to sit." But really all they did was made a sound that got the puppy to look up. But we wanna make sure we're teaching our puppies the correct way so they do actually know the command. So if I take food and I lift it up, the dog's nose goes up, or the puppy nose go up and their butt goes down. Now I'm shaping the behavior of a sit. I'm using a physical cue that's getting my puppy to sit every time. Same thing with down. I lure the puppy to the ground, or I lure the puppy into heel position, or I lure the puppy into the center position, or I get them to spin. Whatever it is, we can use that luring concept to teach all the behaviors we want. Once you have your puppy performing all the behaviors, then you want to start teaching your puppy leash pressure. Leash pressure is also another great way to build our puppy's confidence, because we're putting them in a mildly stressful situation and they're coming out successful. They are winning. And when they win, then their confidence increases. Success builds on success when it comes to working with our dogs or our puppies. So this is a great exercise. It teaches our puppies how to turn off pressure by complying, but it also helps us make obedience training very clear. And it also helps us when we start teaching the stay command. So this is something that's very important. I like to teach this after I teach my dog all the behaviors by using luring, because I can then use luring to help teach my puppy leash pressure. You can learn all about this in my leash pressure video, and I highly recommend checking it out. Once I have my puppy performing all the behaviors with luring and leash pressure, then we're gonna start naming the commands. Now, when you're training your puppy and you're naming commands, don't worry about teaching one behavior at a time. Sit, lift, yes, reward, sit, lift, yes, reward. Doing that over and over and over and over and over again, that's not gonna make the training very fun. Remember what I said at the beginning, we wanna make training as fun as possible. So I like to incorporate all the commands I'm teaching my puppy. One training session, I'm doing multiple sits, multiple downs, come, heel, climb, place, all these different commands, I'm doing it all in one session. Again, it makes the training way more fun for the puppy. They're gonna learn much faster and they're gonna wanna come back for more. And when we're done with the session, we wanna make sure we end when the puppy is engaged, focus, and the puppy's having a good time. We don't want to end the session when they're already becoming bored. We want them wanting to come back for more. So make sure the sessions are short and make sure they are as fun as possible for your puppy. Also, before every single training session, I like to incorporate at least 30 seconds to a minute or so of engagement training. Even though the puppy already knows the markers or the dog knows the marker, starting off with training and doing engagement training gets them into the zone, gets them into the right mindset, and they're gonna learn much faster because of that. So I highly recommend starting every single session with that engagement training. Lastly, once you have all the commands down, your dog is performing them on the verbal command alone, you've taught your dog leash pressure or your puppy leash pressure, then we want to start implementing the stay command. I always like to teach the stay command by teaching the easiest one first. So I'll start with the climb stay, and then I'll do the crate stay with the door open, then maybe the down stay, then the sit stay, then the center stay, then the heel stay, then the stand stay. I want to start with the easiest one, building the puppy with success and getting them to the point where they're able to accomplish the more difficult tasks because they've been successful on the easier ones, such as our climb and our crate. And like I said, we always want to do confidence building. So don't fall into the habit of trying to be the alpha and trying to dominate the dog and alpha rolling and all that. That's all nonsense. Instead, every time you work with your dog or puppy, remember, you are on the same team as your puppy. You're working together towards a common goal, and you're teaching your puppy how to navigate within the human world in ways that other dogs don't. I hope you guys liked today's video. Let me know what you think about it in the comments below. And as always, don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit that notification bell. Thanks again, everybody, and I'll see you in my next video.